fortune of spending many hours in my vehicle so far this week, so I've been able to listen to, I started on the faith book. And one of the things that struck me is that it almost sometimes feels like Nathan's talking to us, and it's so in line with what we've been talking about, especially about the Lord being a now. And I was really struck by, it's a word for right now, even though I don't even know when this book was written, but he was talking to a saint who'd been a believer her whole life, and he was reading scriptures to her, and she said, "Oh, I believed that scripture my whole life." And he said, "No, if you believed it, you wouldn't be in your sickbed right now." I was like, "Ooh, that's tough. That's tough love." But then he said, "You know, knowing it's true isn't the same on acting on the truth and living by the truth." And that's something that I think, as a believer, for me, it's I see things and I know that they're true, but I don't see them manifest in the natural, and so I get frustrated. I'm like, "Lord, what are we missing? What is not going on? Why is when we pray and I believe and I see it as a reality and I know it's true, we don't see the manifestation of it right now?" And he said that hope is an enemy of faith. And I thought about Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. And what struck me, and what I've never saw before, it says, "Now faith is." And I thought, faith is now. Faith is now, not now faith is. It's just another way of saying faith is right now. And he said that you can't faith in the future, you can hope for the future, but you can't faith for the future, you can only faith right now. And that faith, belief in action is faith, and that you have to act on your faith. Well, I don't know how to faith as a verb. I've always thought of faith as a noun, but faith is a verb in the context that he's talking about. And so he said if someone prays for you and you hope you're going to be healed, you won't be healed. You can't hope for healing. You have to believe for healing. You have to actively act. You have to take action on what you believe. And that woman, as he was reading her the scripture, she says, "I believe that my whole life." He goes, "No, you've mentally ascended. You've mentally ascended. You've agreed that that's true your whole life, but you've never put that word in action in your life and seen the manifestation of it, or else you would be doing your work right now, not having me come pray for you." And and he talked about how our knowledge of the truth can somehow impede our action and living by the truth. And so I don't know. I mean, I'm chewing on this. I don't have any big revelation, but I just encourage you guys to seek the word, seek the Lord, because I think there's a nugget and a revelation and a truth here that the Lord is leading us to. And I think it's going to take all of us together to get the marrow out of this truth. But I encourage you to continue to focus on right now. Right now. Not worry about tomorrow, not hope for something in the future, but right now believe, and it is. And we act on that knowledge, that belief. You know, and I thought, and I've been thinking a lot about how Jesus was with people. And I've always felt like we pray for people, but do we ask them what they want? Every time Jesus prayed for somebody, he said, "What do you want? What do you want?" And they declared, they spoke what they wanted, and he said, "Okay, do it. I want to see." He said, "Okay, see. I want to walk. Okay, get up and walk." That's it. He said, "What do you want to do? What do you want from me?" "I want to be healed." "Be healed." So when we're praying for things, I hear the Lord saying, "What do you want?" So when we pray for people who may not understand, you know, the miracles and the signs are for the unbeliever, right? But for us as believers, we need to hold each other accountable. What do you want? What do you want? You know, what do you want? And say the blessing, speak the blessing, not the worry, not the circumstance, but speak the blessing, and then we just declare it as truth. Yes, you're whole. Yes, you're healed. Get up and walk. You know, and I don't know. I mean, that's all I've got so far, but it's challenging me. I mean, it's hard to hear those kind of truths. It's like, "No, if you believed it, you wouldn't be in your bed sick right now." Well, don't tell me I don't believe it, but if you think about it, it's true. So I'm just encouraging you guys. I think that there's a time coming very shortly, and now probably is, where we can no longer be figuring things out. We're going to have to be feeding the people who really need, who really have a mess. We think we're not perfect. We think we're a mess. There are going to be people filling this place that desperately need God. And if we're trying to figure this stuff out, it's not effectual. Our ministry won't be effectual here. And I've always known that God has a special purpose and a special plan for this house. And it's going to take every single one of us. This is a church where people can't come and just hide in the back. This has never been a place where you can just come and go to church. You are here and you're part of the church and you participate in the church. That's how we've always operated here. And I've always thought that this is a church of leaders. God has built a church of leaders, people of substance here that have substantial ministry to be a blessing to those who are going to come. You know. So anyway, I just encourage you guys to continue to dig into the Word. I'm not going to lie, these books are not necessarily an easy listen, but there's a lot of scripture, and if nothing else, just find some nuggets. I mean, I listened for over 3.5 hours and found some really good nuggets. I couldn't write things down because I was driving, but I plan to go back and write some things down that really impressed me and made me think, maybe I don't know as much as I thought I did. You know, and I think about you, Nathan, all the time, and what you said, that the Lord said to read the Bible like you've never seen it before. And I think sometimes we know so much that we have to just stop knowing what we know and just listen to what he's leading us to and believe.
Yeah, I was going to say, too, you know, Tim has said this before, too, but it goes with what you're saying, that, you know, it's kind of like what the Lord said to Joshua when he said, don't let the law depart from your mouth.
Yes.
Don't let my words,
yes,
what I'm saying.
Yes.
We talk about beholding, mm-hmm, Jesus. Well, what happens so many times with us as Christians, and I found this out when I was dealing with the hepatitis C, that we have a mental understanding. We think that, okay, well, then if I ever have to deal with this, I'm ready for it. But the truth is, we need to be speaking the Word all the time. We need to be,
yes,
beholding Christ,
yes,
beholding His Word all the time, and speaking that truth, so that when a crisis comes, because it comes to all of us,
mm-hmm,
we're not playing catch up, you know.
Right.
And that's what happens, like this lady you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We think, you know, we're prepared, but
mm-hmm,
then when we get blindsided by the enemy, we realize we're playing a game of catch up now, because we,
mm-hmm,
really weren't operating in faith all this time. We were just making mental agreement, say, yeah, well, that's true,
yeah,
but we don't apply it. We're not applying it, and that's part of this whole idea of being conscious of our connection with the Lord, our oneness with God. Because,
mm-hmm,
he said, I only say what my Father says.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're saying all kinds of other stuff because it doesn't,
yeah,
we don't think it matters,
right,
because we're not going through something.
That's good, yeah.
And,
mm-hmm,
the problem is, then we're going through something, and now we've got to readjust all of our thinking and the way that we respond to everything. So we're behind the eight ball,
yeah,
so to speak.
Exactly.
I wonder then, why don't we get manifestation? And so I think and the other thing is, we have to just continue in that,
yes,
continue in His Word. Whether we see manifestation or not,
absolutely,
the reality is we are already, it's already accomplished.
Mm-hmm.
And, but it's our faith wavers based on evidence around us, you know what I'm,
mm-hmm,
saying? So again, that's another reason why the more we operate in this awareness and beholding Him and His Word and saying what He says all the time, it has us set up so then when we are confronted with the situation, our natural reaction to it is,
mm-hmm,
to say what Jesus
the
would
word,
say.
Yeah.
So I think that has a lot to do with it. So it isn't just about, you know, the metaphysical idea of us and Jesus occupying the same space. It's that He literally is in us,
yes,
just as the Father was in Him. When you think about it, Jesus didn't do any miracles until the Holy Spirit came upon Him. He was filled with the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He was full of God.
Yeah.
And how many of us are filled with the Spirit, but the Spirit hasn't really come on us, you know what I'm saying? So
right,
we're not operating by the Spirit, even
right,
though we are filled with it.
Right.
And that
true,
goes back to the Word, so. Amen.
And it was when the Holy Spirit came upon Him is when He said, this is my beloved Son,
exactly,
in whom I'm well pleased. Yeah.
It was already there.
Right.
That reality existed. But this was like the evidence, not
yeah,
only for everybody around Him, but for Jesus as well.
Yeah. Yeah, so I guess I'll just, I wanted to read all of Hebrews 11:1 because it's, I'm looking at it differently, I guess, now than I have before. But it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And, you know, I know we talked on Sunday that the elders obtained the good report. I mean, we're talking about when the spies went into the land, there were only two that came back and said, we can take it. So let's all decide to be the two and say,
right,
we can take it, you know? Anybody have any prayer requests? Yeah, testimonies?
Well,
yeah.
You were talking about how this is a church that people can just come here and sit in the back. I don't know if you remember, that's how I started. I used to sit in that back pew with a choir. I tried to sneak my way out when the service was over. It took me a while to actually step up and start talking to Mike. Hey, you know, play music.
Yeah.
So that was kind of like my awakening. So I was thinking about that when you said that. It's true, because that's how I started. Look where I am right now.
Exactly.
I'm in the front.
Yeah.
But then when you were talking about faith and hope being two different things, I started thinking back to that series that
mm-hmm.
we've heard before, Framing Your World in
yeah.
Words.
Yeah.
He talks about that in that series, and he explains the difference and how, you know, just hoping for something is not taking action. He says,
right.
I got to go back and and listen to that. And then when you were saying that when people went to Jesus, he's like, what do you want? Well, I want this. It makes you think, and it's almost like you have to change the way you pray. It's not like, please, God, give me wisdom. It's not like, God, I want wisdom, and I want revelation, and I want guidance, so I know you're going to give it to me.
Amen.
So just ask for it that way. So that's the little nugget that I got from what you spoke. And then I have some prayer requests. One is, my mom this morning asked me to pray for a friend of hers. Her name is Mari. They found a lump in one of her breasts, and they did a biopsy, and it came back positive. So now she is distraught, and she feels like the world has ended, and she doesn't know what to do. So my mom is very sad about that. So we can pray for her that God gets hold of her and reveals to her, you know, this is my plan for your life, my purpose for you, so that she can start seeing things and declaring things. If you can stand with me on that. Another thing is, for some reason today when I was at work, I was doing something on the computer, and then Ariadna just popped into my head, and I felt this need to pray for her. So if we can pray for her, I the things that I asked God to do for her was to give her wisdom, revelation, guidance, like I just mentioned, but also that she answers his call, because I know he has a purpose for her, and it has to do with children. And that the things that she's doing right now in her life, I mean, I haven't talked to her in over a year, so I have no idea what's going on in her life, but that the things that she's doing and the decisions that she's making are not only good for her, but also honoring to him. So that's what I was praying for, if you can stand with me on that. And also on the way over here, there was an accident on Euclid and 16th, and both cars were taking both lanes coming east, and the drivers were stuck in the car. So if we can pray for those people that nothing bad happened, and their families don't get to receive any bad news tonight.
Amen.
Pray for that.
Amen. Yeah. Anyone else? Any prayer requests? Tim.
Yes. Thank you for sharing that tonight, because that was on the radio today. Christian radio was Hebrews 11. So that's good you shared that. And one of the things that was on my heart today was Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Yes.
That song. And when you just realize how faithful God is to you so many times throughout the day, you know, when things could happen and they don't happen, we don't always look at divine protection in any given day, you know. I know on TV they had the tornadoes that hit, and I just brought back a flashback that I was going to visit my mom, and we had stopped to get a stay at a hotel about 20 miles out, and it was on the news, and so we just prayed for mom, said we'll be there And it just jumped right over hers. And it wasn't even a mile away. It tore a bunch of new houses up. But mom's was just like it always been. It's just like it came down and hopped like he's playing checkers or something, you know. And it just brought it back to memory. And also, I just like to continue to pray. I've been praying for the Lord. Continue to pray for her because she did receive the Lord. And you can see the change. You can see it in her posts and stuff. But you can see there's a lot of seeking going on at this time.
Mm-hmm.
And I just ask you really pray for her direction. Because she's grieving too. I mean, to have, her friend died and say, as soon as she got out of the hospital, it was like that next week, he died, you know, and it was just like all that rolled together. And the biggest question was asked, which is an honest question, is why am I still here, you know? Why was, you know, I'm allowed to stay and that person allowed to go? I mean, it's just a lot of questions. And I always have to point them that God's the only one with all the answers. Heaven is, because some things might make sense. But God's still God, no matter what.
Amen.
So we definitely would appreciate your prayers. And
yes.
The last one was a friend at work. He's been off since the middle of December with some knee issues. And we don't know when he's going to come back. You know, and I know it's hard because he's only been there a year and a half. So, you know, you run out of sick days and you run out of things like that. But we just ask you to, keep him in prayer.
Yeah. Amen.
So she doesn't know what's going on. He's on blood thinners, whether it's too thin, but she was waiting for a phone call to find out what the hell was going on with him. So she's really concerned now.
Okay. All right, yeah, Mike.
I naturally working with the group kids, 12 and older, Christ in Action is their group name. And naturally, after the way Sunday morning went, I knew there was going to be questions from these young ones. Like, what the heck was that? You know. So, one instance, Meredith, a guest that Kennedy brought and stuff was, well, how come that lady was laying on the floor and crying and stuff like that when she was praying for that, for Reed and stuff like that? And I asked. I told them basically, you know, the Lord was on her, and she had, the Lord was working through her, and she just felt the heaviness of the weightiness of the presence of the Lord on her as she was praying. And naturally later on Facebook, I asked Jody to share what she experienced on there so Rita could show this to Meredith, you know, of what Jody's words were. So like I said, we have to be ready. These kids are asking what's going on, and as Nicole came up and was singing and stuff like that, one of the first words that came out of her mouth was, I was scared. I says, were you scared, afraid, or scared of not knowing what's going on or what? She goes, I don't know how to put it in words and stuff. I says, did it feel like the presence of the Lord was just all over you and you didn't know how to react? And she said, yes. So, it's on now. It's already on. So these girls are hungry, and I talked to Rita about if she wanted to borrow my DVD One Night with the King, Tommy Tenney did with the story of Esther. The youth are studying about Esther now, and Rita thought, I don't think Kennedy would be too interested in that, you know, it's just not her cup of tea or whatever else. Well, after reading the first chapter, Esther going through with Xerxes and his wife, Vashti, and Memucan, the misguided leaders or advisor and stuff like that, just through the first chapter, Sunday afternoon they get home, Grandma, can I watch One Night with the King? So it's on.
Awesome.
So, praise the Lord.
Yeah, and I wanted to praise the Lord. Speaking of tornadoes, guess where I was last night? I was in Clinton, Iowa, on the Mississippi. And one of our analysts went with me, and of course she's on the radar, you know, and I'm like, I don't need to see the radar, we're gonna be fine. And she's like, but it's all around us. And I'm like,
mm-hmm.
We'll be fine. She's like, I love that you're so positive and so naive. I got the radar on my phone. Not only did we not get poured on until we were already in City Hall, I actually missed the exit to go up 161, which is where the tornado was. I actually ended up on the River Road. It took me 4 extra minutes to get there. Had still plenty of time for the city council meeting last night, and not a drop of rain on us. And we came back, and she's like, oh, we're going to drive right into it. I said, let me just tell you, we're going to be just fine. Not a drop of rain on us all the way from Clinton until we got back into Des Moines 11:30 last night. And it was everywhere. And I'm talking like we were driving right into it. She goes, we're driving into it. I said, it's going to be south of the interstate by the time we get there. She goes, you are so positive. I'm like, no, I'm blessed and highly favored.
There you go.
And so it led to some very good discussion on the way home. You know, as far as, you know, psychic abilities and what do I believe, and, you know, her struggles as a believer as a young girl. And is the Sylvia Brown, you know, Sylvia Brown, she read a Sylvia Brown book because she had a tragedy happen in her teen years and she was trying to understand because she believes in God, but how does he let bad things happen? And it was just a really interesting discussion. So no tornadoes. We got to City Hall, found out there were tornadoes, didn't even know there were tornadoes, and it literally went right by us. We drove up through LeClaire and Comanche, right on the river. And if we would have taken 161 north like we were supposed to and go right through DeWitt and then over, we would have driven right that storm. But oopsie, I missed the exit because I was talking, imagine that, and had to take an alternate route. I'm like, wait a minute, I thought we were going north. We're still going east. I think we're driving to Chicago. Hopefully there's an exit that'll get us where we're going. Garmin still says we'll be there in time. Good thing we left early. So anyway, I praise the Lord that he can turn my chattiness into a blessing in Jesus' name. So, yeah. Anyone else tonight?
Jamie has something.
Okay. Anybody else before we pray tonight? All right, well, let's pray, Jane.
Speak health, divine health for me.
Thank you, Lord, that you continue to pour out wisdom and revelation in this body. Open our eyes to see and open our ears to hear, Lord. Help us to guard the words that flow from our mouth, Lord. Let us speak words of life and truth and wisdom, full of faith, Lord, not hoping but knowing and resting in your finished work, Lord. Help us to put our faith into action, Lord. Help us to live a life full of love, full of grace, and that everywhere we go, Lord, we bring life, salt, and light. Jesus, have your way tonight in this service. We ask your blessing upon our pastor, upon the word, the seed that is planted, Lord, that it would bear good fruit in this body for the glory of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord. Eastern Gatehouse Prayer. I'm looking all, I don't even know who's got it. I don't even know what I'm doing. I'm just, sorry. I don't have any psychic abilities, clearly. So Eastern Gate, Friday, March 10th. I encourage anybody who can be here. And the following day on Saturday's prayer room.
Amen. Amen. I talked to the worship team earlier about it. There's a friend of ours who I've known for years, Steve Bradshaw, who mostly is working with an inner city church and is also sometimes goes up to Hamlin and stuff like that. So I've been always chasing after revival. He's been down to Brownsville and stuff like that. But he had a dream in San Diego last week and said he got woke up from it. Basically, he was saying revival broke out in this area on March 12th. And I know we don't know the day or the hour. A lot of these things are going to happen and stuff like that. But I thought it was kind of coincidental that it happened after God's people were getting together for 48 hours previous to any of this stuff, because pastors even mentioned that Sundays after our Easter Gate Houses of Prayer, there are different things start happening and bubbling and stuff. And I saw posts even up at Kingdom House of Prayer after they went in their war room and stuff last month and stuff like that. Things start manifesting up there too. But God inhabits the praises of his people.
Yes,
we go seeking after him. He's going to answer. He's going to show up. And a lot of it I'm seeing, and pastors mention it many times in different ways, is it's not so much that God shows up. God's already here. It's just that God is getting, and his kingdom is getting released out of the people that are coming.
That's right.
Yes,
the kingdom is getting
amen.
Released.
Yeah.
So if you can make it, our set for Abundant Life or Eastern Gate House of Prayer, same thing. It's 5 to 7 p.m. on Saturday. We're going to pursue God and bring the fire. Bring the fire.
Amen. And one more announcement that we'll get a slide for after we meet on Sunday. We are planning to do a women's conference, our first ever women's conference here at Abundant Life, preliminarily, not
I'm
set
not
in stone
coming.
Yet. Huh?
I'm not coming.
Well, you're not invited, but thank you anyway.
you
can come and serve the ladies of the church if you would like. But you know, there's going to be food, there's going to be fellowship, there's going to be worship and prayer. We're encouraging all the women of the church to find out how they want to be a part of it. We're hoping everybody will participate in some way, whether it's, you know, 2 minutes or leading prayer or just something, somehow, something to pour out of all of us, because I think we need to start with each other. And if we can start to learn to engage in our ministry and our gifts and our abilities and put our faith in action together, then when other people come, hopefully it'll just be natural. So preliminarily, we picked Saturday, April 22nd. Shelley thought the 22nd was significant because Strong's 2222 in the Greek and the Hebrew both mean the same thing, which is highly unusual, and I don't remember what it means right now, but it's something about more and water. Don't remember?
Isaiah 22:22 also talks about giving you the keys of the city.
Keys of the city, okay. And it's Earth Day, which I don't know if that means anything or not, but that's kind of the day we picked, but more information to come. Anybody who is here Sunday that would like to participate, I think we're going to try and either meet right after church on Sunday or at least set up a meeting time to meet right after church on Sunday. So more information to come. Please be praying, all you ladies, how you want to get involved, and we hope you can come for at least part of the day. I know it's a Saturday in spring, but hopefully everybody can come for at least part of the day.
Just a quick insert on that. I don't know if anybody's ever been familiar with the Awake Denver conferences that that's a call. All I know is all the guys that either had to be ushers or, you know, just working non in the congregation, since it was a women's conference and stuff. Every one of those guys I talked to that were there helping out and stuff like that says it's just totally crazy. It's just, God's just all over everything. It's just, guys can't do this. It's God working through women in a certain way that most of the time guys can't understand, which is fine. But it gets wild, and I anticipate this going on. I may be helping out with the sound and stuff like that, or with the music and stuff, but all I know is I'm just going to sit back and watch this craziness. It's going to be crazy.
Well, not that it gets crazy when a bunch of women get together or anything, but anything goes, no boundaries. That's kind of been our theme so far in our discussions, is no boundaries. So, and the Lord told me the first time someone brought this, because we used to have a women's Bible study. We had somewhat of a women's ministry, and Joni was a big part of that. And since Joni passed away, we've never picked it back up. And so Sarah has really wanted to pick that mantle back up. And since we started talking about this, I really felt that it's the Esther anointing, the governmental anointing, but the Lord told me women of influence. So that's what we're naming the conference. That's what I'm kind of informally naming the women's ministry. I think it's going to be bigger than this church eventually, but women of influence is kind of where we're starting. So, and I'm feeling a theme of no boundaries. So, yeah. So let's speak the word tonight.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Ron, would you please come take the offering tonight?
Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. Father, we just thank you right now for what you've already done. We know, Lord, that your word tells us that whatever we ask, we give a petition, and according to your word, in agreement with your word, we know that you've heard us. And if you hear us, then we know that we have our petition. So we celebrate the victory right now, Lord, over every prayer that was prayed here tonight, Lord, because it was in your will. They were in the will of God, in what your purpose is in people's lives. And so we release our faith right now and just believe for tremendous testimonies of what you're doing in people's lives as a result of our confidence in you. You are a great and a mighty God, and with you nothing is impossible, Lord. And we thank you, Jesus, for your faithfulness in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening and sharing with us. Good to see Peter. Praise the Lord. Great to have you here tonight, Peter.
Only for a limited time.
We know that he's, this is kind of a revolving door thing, but we understand he's got some issues he's dealing with, and that's a good thing because it's moving him and his family forward, and I believe, as he does, that he's being obedient to the Lord, and it's a way for God to open some doors for them, and we're excited about that for them, and just, I'd appreciate it, and I know Peter would too, if you just continue to remember him in prayer, and believe that God is just going to hold him up and help him to get through this, and have confidence that God is certainly opening doors for him, and giving him the desires of his heart. That's what the scripture says God wants to do for all of us, right? So we get a vision for something, and then we just kind of lean into God and see it come to pass. Amen. And we believe that's what's going to happen exactly for Peter. Praise the Lord, and for his family. So praise the Lord. Thank all of you for sharing your prayer requests and standing in the gap for others, being there as a point of contact for God to be able to reach out to them and minister to them. So it's exciting what God is doing. Amen.
Amen.
So it's Wednesday night, and we'll try to be brief. Get you all out of here before temperatures get any colder. Praise the Lord. But cheer up. Hallelujah. It's going to be just average temperatures for the next couple of days. And then this weekend it's supposed to be in the 60s. Nearly 70 degrees by Sunday. So hallelujah. This too shall pass. Praise
Amen.
The Lord. Amen. We're having some great weather. And I'll tell you what. Been a lot of Februarys when a day like today would have been a blessing. Praise the Lord, when we were shoveling, inches of snow away. So thank the Lord. All right, well, let's get right to the Word of God this evening. And I'd like to begin with John, the book of John, chapter 3. And I want to read verses 5 through 12. John 3, 5 through 12. Praise God. Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus answered and said unto him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said unto him, "Art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things, and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things?" And then I would like to read one verse from Matthew chapter 19, verse 26. Matthew 19, verse 26. Jesus beheld them and said unto them, "With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Amen. So this Pharisee comes to Jesus, and wanting knowledge. He's wanting revelation, information. But when Jesus gives it to him, he can't handle it. He doesn't grasp the spiritual reality of this. And so he's asking questions that are, in Jesus' words, earthly, rather than seeing the spiritual context in which Jesus is speaking. And, you know, the world that we live in is crazy. You know, we're bombarded with information. And it's easy to be overwhelmed with it all. And because of the volume of it sometimes, it's easy to not comprehend everything that we're being told. You know, some of the information that we miss could improve our lives in dramatic ways. I mean, more than, you know, a greater gas discount from our grocery purchases. And more than endless refills at Quick Trip. Or, you know, you buy one meal and then you get the buffet free. It's all good information, but there's things we need to know that go way beyond that. See, some believers go through life without knowing what blessings are available to us, without knowing or believing what can actually be included. I was thinking of Jamie's talking about these Catholics. Well, a lot of my family are Catholic. Thank the Lord, most of them are what are called charismatic Catholics, which means they have accepted Christ as their Savior, but they still go through all of the other ritual. Sadly, a lot of Catholics, good, well-meaning Catholics, people that love God and are faithful, really do not have a relationship with Christ because they have substituted all of the ritual for the reality, right?
Right.
But we could say that about a lot of Christians or a lot of church-going people.
Right.
That they go to church, they do the stuff, but they really don't have that encounter with Jesus that changes them, that really makes this life what it's supposed to be, that makes God real, more than just a ceremony, mm-hmm. but a real person. Amen?
Amen.
And so they go through life and they miss the blessings. They miss the closeness, the oneness with God. Without knowing and realizing what God wants to include in their life. Let's look at this. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, very familiar scripture. Talks about my people perish for lack of knowledge, or they're destroyed for lack of knowledge. And that's not what I'm really focused on, the first part of this, because this is Old Testament, and I'm not putting everybody under a curse here, but this is still a reality. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will reject you. Well, it isn't so much that God rejects them. I mean, that's just kind of a way of saying it. It's like when the scripture says, if any man rejects Christ or refuses, Paul was talking about the gospel. He said, if anybody refuses this, let him be cursed. He wasn't putting a curse on him. He was just saying, you got this option here, is either you accept Christ or you're still under the curse.
Right.
Curse of the law, right? Well, that's basically what the writer here is saying by the Holy Spirit, is that, you know, you're destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Because you reject knowledge, here's what happens. You reject God, you reject God's truth, and these are the results of it. Not that God's causing it to happen, it's just if you're not going to accept Christ, or if you're not going to accept God, then you're stuck with the consequences. Amen? So, that word is destroy. My people are destroyed. Now, that's a powerful thing. That word is dama in the Hebrew, and it's not any accident that it's used here, and it's a strong word. It means to suffer destruction or spiritual death. To cease, it says. To be brought to silence. To be utterly undone. So without knowledge, we find ourselves in the middle of destruction. Without the words to speak. Undone. Mm-hmm. So if you consider the ominous
nature of this definition, I can't help but wonder, what knowledge do I lack? And how do I get it? Psalms 139, and I want to read 1 through 14. Mike. Psalms 139, verses 1 through 14.
O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. Whither shall I go from thy spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. For thou hast possessed my reins, thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well.
I just, you know, I don't want to be too morose here. I'm not trying to be, but I do think this is serious. We need seriously to be connected to the Lord, to be led by the Lord. Because I'm going to tell you something right now. I've done everything that I can to not be overly influential in your lives on purpose. In other words, I don't want to be the go-between for you and Jesus.
Right.
My job, as I see it, as I understand it in the Holy Spirit, my call is to teach, is to preach, but it's to connect you to the Spirit of God, mm-hmm. to the best of my ability. Mm-hmm. Now, everybody does this differently because we're all different people. But I, if you don't, somebody will. If you're not being completely influenced by God, somebody else will try to influence you. I've been in this thing too long to not know that.
Right.
I've had too many people come along and try to tell me what to do and how to do it, or behind my back try to do that, subtly. I don't worry about it. I'm not freaked out about it. I don't spend a lot of time laying awake at night about it because I'm doing what God told me to do, and what everybody else does, that's between them and the Lord. But I'm just saying, we need to be in tune with God. Mm-hmm. It's what Suzanne was talking about up here. It's what Tim was talking about Sunday. If we're not, other voices will lead you and guide you into junk that you don't want to be in.
That's right.
It may sound right.
Come on.
It may look right. And it isn't about people.
Absolutely not.
It's about spiritual influence.
That's right.
Praise the Lord. So, if we don't see ourselves as God sees us, and understand, that scripture is probably one of the most beautiful scriptures there are about how God and we interact and connect. We don't have to be afraid of anything.
Amen.
Just based on that 14 verses alone is enough to convince me that God knows all about me. He's not upset with me. I can't run away from him. No matter what I do, he's going to be there, and he's always there in a loving way, in a way that he wants to promote me, that he wants to help me and bless me. With that, the scripture comes to my mind, if God is for you, who can be against you? What do you got to worry about? I mean, why would we care? Amen? But sadly, if we're not in tune, we don't
don't see ourselves that way. We see ourselves as separated from God, or God is afar off. Or let me just use this example. When Moses was a baby, the Pharaoh decreed that all of the Hebrew babies would be killed, right?
Right.
We all know the story, so I'm not going there to the scripture, because you know it's true, and I'm not making this up. If you just look at the story, you'd say, God had a purpose for Moses from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
From literally before he was born,
yeah.
Right.
God had a plan and a purpose for his life. Just what God is saying right here to each one of us. But years later, Moses didn't see himself the way God saw him. Look at Matthew chapter 19 and verse 20. Excuse me, Exodus chapter 3, verse 10. And this just kind of goes through it real quickly, what I'm talking about. Moses knew originally, he had to have known, or he wouldn't have acted the way he did. And it's clear to us, having read the story multiple times and heard it preached and everything else, that God had a plan. God had a purpose for his life from the very beginning. From the time they put him in the bulrushes and floated him out into the Nile to save him from the killers that were coming. Amen. But here the Lord meets up with Moses and says, come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And it reminds me of that famous line by Robert De Niro, are you talking to me? Praise the Lord. Because that's exactly how he responds. Moses totally focused on his weaknesses.
Yep.
Now, Exodus chapter 3, verse 11. See, we don't do a lot of things simply because we don't see ourselves the way God sees us. We take somebody else's word for it. We take our own inadequacies and fears and so on and so forth, and so we don't step out and do things. Praise the Lord. And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? Why are you choosing me? Who am I that I should go? Now, let me just say this. I don't pastor the largest church in Des Moines. I don't know. There could be some debate whether it's the smallest. But I'm doing what God called me to do.
Amen.
And I've been doing it for quite a while. And I did it because I believed that that's what God was telling me to do 35, 40 years ago, whatever it's been now, if I go all the way back to when we were in Texas. Everything in the natural told me, this isn't right. You're not equipped. You shouldn't be doing this. This isn't what you... There's other things you should be doing, other things you could be doing. But I really did believe that it was the Lord. And the miraculous part of it is, believe me, Sally and I are not getting rich, so you know, relax. But God does supply our needs.
Amen.
Here's an example. We had to buy our refrigerator shot craps. We've had it for 18 years, ever since we built the house that we live in. Which is just, it's not a fancy house. It's just a little Cape Cod-like cottage type house. And it's a nice house. I mean, we love it. We're happy there and everything. But it's nothing extravagant or fancy or, you know, it's just a house. It's our home is what it is. But anyway, the refrigerator in our home, Sally had to have to get up every morning and scrape ice out of the bottom of the freezer for the last few months because it was leaking water, and then it would freeze in the freezer, and then it wouldn't seal, and I mean, just stuff. So we had to get another refrigerator. Well, the one we had was a double door thing, and she wanted the single door with the freezer on the bottom, and I don't know, that's her territory. I just went with her to get it. So anyway, we buy the refrigerator. They delivered it last Friday, got it hooked up and everything. And she went back to take back. They didn't actually hook it up. I ended up hooking up the water line for the ice maker and stuff. So she had to go back and take back the water line and some other stuff that they were supposed to install, which they didn't, and we paid for it. So she took it back to get our to
get the money back. Well, in the process, you got to know Sally. She shops. I don't shop. I buy. I just go get what I'm thinking I got to have. But she shops. That's why we don't go together when we go shop. Because I go with a purpose, and I get whatever it is I'm going after, and then I go, I'm done.
Amen.
Yeah,
no, no,
no.
Amen.
Yeah, so I'm on a mission, you know. I need a pair of jeans. I'm going to go. I know what size I got to get. You know, I'm just going to go get them, and I got them, and I'm out of there.
Well, how much
so I'm successful. I'm successful. What did they cost? I don't know. I don't remember, you know. So anyway, but she's shopping all the time. But anyway, she's there, and she happens to go to another store where they had the same exact refrigerator on sale, but for like $300 cheaper. So she calls up the store where we bought the one we have, and she said, do you have a policy where you match prices? And they said, well, yeah.
Doors open.
So she went back today, got the stuff from the store that had the refrigerator for sale for $300 less, mm-hmm. took it to the other store, got our money, got the discounted value of it, and saved us $300, which is $300. I mean, come
Amen.
On, you know, I mean, $300 is $300.
Thank you.
We've got a lot of places we could spend that $300 besides on that refrigerator. But I'm just saying that, see, we settle for things a lot of times because we just don't pay attention. Now, this is a natural thing, but God did this. God, I mean, I've heard Tim talk about this, and we all do this. We all see it. And it may sound like a small thing, but if you're the one that has to come up with the $300, it's a big deal.
That's right.
Right? I mean, it's $300. And so, you know, that's God.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He didn't tell me. He told Sally. Because he knew if he told me, I'd go, what? I don't have time to run over here and get this and run over there and do that and then stand in line again, you know, to go through the whole thing. But he knew she would. If it took 3 days, she'd be there to get that $300. But that's a blessing from God.
Yes, it is.
Amen. And the more you need the $300, the bigger the blessing, right?
Amen.
So praise God. But I mean, that's what God does in the little things and the big things. To me, we got to have a refrigerator, otherwise we can't eat. Or we got to go out to eat all the time, and that's expensive. So, you know, we got to have a refrigerator.
Mm-hmm.
But not only do we need a refrigerator, we need a deal on the refrigerator, right?
That's right.
So it isn't just about having a need, but it's God supplying the need and then blessing us in the process so that we can see God's hand is involved in it. Now, some people would say, oh, you're just stretching. No. I just read to you, God is involved in everything in our lives.
Yeah.
The little things that may be little things to some people can be big things to somebody else. God, it's important to him because he knows it's important to you or to us in this case. Amen? So here's Moses, and God is saying, you know, you're special. I got this call on your life, and I want to do this. And Moses is saying, me? Why? I'm not good at this. Why should I go? He's focused on himself, on his weaknesses, on his failures. Look at Exodus chapter 4, verse 1. This is continuing on here. Because I'm telling you, God has a plan for your life. And it's important. You may see yourself right now and just say, well, look, I'm doing this and I'm doing that. No. God has got a plan, and he has chosen you for that plan, and it's critical that you see yourself having value. I'm not talking about arrogance or pride. I'm saying having a value to God, because otherwise he wouldn't be calling you. He wouldn't have chosen you. You wouldn't be here.
Right.
So Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice, for they'll say, the Lord hath not accepted unto thee, or the Lord has not appeared unto thee.
Mm-hmm.
So he's saying, what if I'm not good enough?
Yeah.
What if they believe me? Chapter 4, verse 10. Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I'm not eloquent,
neither heretofore nor since thou hast spoken unto thy servant. I wasn't eloquent before you spoke to me, and I'm not now, right? I'm slow of speech. I have a slow tongue. He says, what about my flaws? Everybody else pointed them out to me. Everybody else knows about them. I'm well aware of them. What about them? I'm slow of speech. Exodus chapter 4, verse 13. And he said, oh, my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him whom thou wilt send. Oh, God, send somebody else. What about my flaws? I'm slow of speech. I can't do this. So when all the excuses don't work, and God's saying, I'm still dealing with you. You're still the one I want. I still got a plan for you. I got a purpose for you. When all the excuses don't work out, the last resort is beg. Please, don't send me. Send somebody else. I'm afraid I'll fail. I know I will. Think about it. Moses had God himself giving him instructions. And so do we. This is for us. This is for each and every one of us. Not for a special person. Not for certain people. For every one of us. Moses' mistake was looking at himself through his own eyes. In the natural. Instead of by the Spirit, the way God saw him. That's why it's incredibly important, and why I've been talking about this for a while, that we see ourselves one with God.
Yes.
Because then you cannot fail. With God, nothing shall be impossible. With God. You with God. Nothing is impossible. It's not abstract. It's not God's over there, nothing's impossible for him. Of course we know that, but he's with us. We are one with him. So with God, nothing is impossible for us.
Yes.
Unless we're seeing God over there and us over here. Then it becomes about us, our flaws, our weaknesses, our failures, our inadequacies. And we start begging. Just let me sit there. Just let me come and go. Don't put any demands on me, Lord. I always screw it up. Romans chapter 9, verse 20. Suzanne said, talking about new people that come and people that will come and that got issues, that have lots of issues. If you are not confident of God in your life, you're not of a whole lot of value to somebody else with problems. I'm not picking on people. I'm saying we got to believe or we don't do anything. We'll never step out. We'll never take the risk to do what God wants to do in our life. Now let others measure success and failure. If you're doing what God told you, you're a success. Amen. I want the church to grow because of what that means. Not so that I can say 300 people go to this church. But so that 300 people can be touched and influenced and interacting with God Almighty that otherwise might not have.
Come on.
But I've never measured, and some people may say, well, he doesn't care, or he's just not aggressive enough. No, I'm just who I am. I'm the same guy I was when God called me.
Right.
Sally says a smart aleck. Yeah, but that's me, and God knew it before Sally. Praise the Lord. So I'm just saying, this is the reason for the repetition. It comes by hearing, and by hearing, and by hearing. It isn't that I haven't got something else I can preach. I've been doing this for 30-some years. I can find something else to preach. God can give me something else to preach, but I'm going to preach what God gives me. That's what I'm going to preach.
That's right.
So this is what God's dealing with me about right now.
And that's why I'm sharing it with you. And here's the thing. If you feel like you're here because you feel like God put you here, or that this is where you feel like you should be, that God wants you to be here, then you have to come to the conclusion that God knew I was going to be the one pastoring here.
There you go. Yep.
Right?
There you go.
Now, that's not to pat myself on the back, or, like I said, I try not to let my ego get in the way. I don't have a huge ego when it comes to this kind of stuff. Because I learned early on, if God isn't in it, it's just a big embarrassment for me. I mean, I've dropped the melon plenty of times, as the preachers like to say. Praise the Lord. So I know. So I'm just trying to obey God in the way that God knows me to be. And however that influences is determined by you.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
I mean, you either receive it or you don't.
Right.
Right? So this is Moses. And I'm not preaching about me here. I'm talking about you, but I can relate to Moses because I had all the same issues. I mean, I was a drunk because I was a salesman and I didn't like being up in front of people. Now imagine that. You talk about anxiety. Every single day of my working life was trying to sell a product to somebody who either didn't want it or had 50 other people trying to sell them something just like it. And I just didn't like the interaction. I didn't like having to do it. I didn't like anything about it, but I could make money doing it, so I did, but it caused me to drink all the time. I mean, just a little example. When we lived in East Texas, before we got saved, I'd get up in the morning before I'd leave if I was in town, if I was in the local area, so I wasn't out on the road. And I'd go out in the kitchen. I'd get a cup of coffee. I'd reach up and get the bottle of vodka out of the cupboard. Pour a drinking glass, not a shot glass, a drinking glass, like you would drink iced tea out of it. And I'd fill it 3/4 of the way up. I'd drink that down, drink my coffee, and go to my first call. And I'd do that periodically throughout the day. I was a functional drunk. I wasn't staggering. I wasn't slurring. I would just be high. And it made me comfortable enough to where I could interact. You can imagine when God started dealing with me about preaching, I thought, I don't think they'll let me drink before I preach. You know? I just don't think that'll work. But that had been my crutch. That had been my way of dealing with the stress and so forth. But see, God's not like us. He's got a sense of humor. He had something he wanted me to do, and he wasn't going to let me use my own devices to do it. I was going to have to depend on him.
Yep.
I was going to have to trust him. When everything in me said, this ain't going to work. This can't work. And yet something greater in me kept pushing me in that direction, saying, this is what you've got to do, because you'll never be happy doing anything else. You'll never be satisfied. I'm not always happy doing this, but I'm always satisfied doing this. I feel fulfilled, you know what I'm saying? So even when it's not good, it's still good. You know, it's like they say, you get a job you love, you'll never work a day in your life.
There you go.
So I don't consider this a job, although there's routine and there's stuff you have to do, but I'm just saying, in that, thinking of it that way. Well, so back to this. Nay, but O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Yeah. Believe me, I've looked at all these scriptures. Because I thought, God, just like Moses, this is what Moses is doing. This is what we all do. God tells us to do something, we say, well, come on, God, you know I'm not good at that, or I can't do this, or I'm not comfortable doing that, or this is going to be too stressful, or whatever. Who are we to say to the one that created us, who knows us better than we know ourselves, I think you missed it this time. Because everybody knows me that I don't do well at this. You see what I'm saying? So what happens a lot of times is we build up this spiritual, we take our shot of vodka, only it's not a shot of vodka, it's this spiritual facade that we do stuff that is not natural. It's not supernatural either. It's just religious. But it seems spiritual because it's not like we usually are. You understand what I'm saying? When God has called us for who we are, that he created us to be, and he wants us to operate supernaturally as we are. Amen?
Amen.
See, there are things I could do. I'll tell you, I was a Pentecostal preacher for years. Mm-hmm. I evangelized. I know how high to jump and how far to run and how loud to shout. I mean, I know what is, I'm not saying everybody that does this is phony. I'm just saying there's a lot of stuff that is not the Spirit of God. It's just people trying to be a blessing, trying to encourage, trying to get people to have confidence. Call it the anointing and whatever you want to. Listen, you are anointed 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. You cannot be anything other than that because you have the anointed one living in you. That's just a question of how you display that anointing.
Yes, Lord.
We got to learn to be ourselves. God was happy. God didn't have a problem with Moses' slow speech. He didn't have a problem with any of that. He said, you're the one I'm wanting to do this. And I know all your stuff.
Yeah.
But I still want you. And in fact, I'm not settling for anything but you.
Come on.
Praise God. So everything changed at the burning bush, this God encounter. And God wants to do the same thing for you.
Amen.
The way you are is not an accident.
Come on.
You need to chase, chase, how God sees you.
Yes.
That'll take you out of your comfort zone. It'll cause you to have to trust God, but it will change your life.
Come on.
And it'll have an impact on people that you never thought you could have an impact on.
Glory.
The original, authentic you. The you that God knew in your mother's womb. Not the one you see in the mirror. The new creature in Christ. So can you see why I'm talking about the things that I'm talking about? Because I know a little bit about people. I'm not a psychiatrist. I'm not a psychologist. You can't live as long as I've lived and not learn something about people. Because you live with yourself.
Yep.
The new creation, the new creature in Christ. God is reminding you of the truth. He says you were in Christ before the foundation of the world.
Yes.
He saw you one with Jesus in your uniqueness. Before any of your ancestry even hit this planet. Any of them.
Yep.
So, God is reminding you of the truth. Psalms 139, verse 14 again. No, just verse 14 is good enough. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well.
Amen.
All right, Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. If we really believe that, church, you'll have boldness and confidence and courage to do things that you will never do in the natural.
Amen.
Because it's no longer you, your image, your idea of you, your definition of you, but it's the Christ in you that has taken over your life.
Amen.
And I'm not talking about living without failures, without sin, without coming short. I'm talking about living your life the way God destined it to be.
Yes.
Your purpose. Your true identity.
Amen.
Remember when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden? They ate the apple, right? They ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And what happened? They were ashamed, right? So they covered themselves with fig leaves. Now, before, they didn't have a problem with their natural identity, their true identity, their reality. The moment they were separated from God, the moment they didn't have that oneness with God anymore, their revelation or their understanding of good and evil caused them to be ashamed of themselves.
Mm-hmm.
To the point that they went out and got fig leaves and tried to cover themselves up. They never had a problem with this before. They were able to be themselves before God without any sense of shame or guilt or uncomfortableness. And all of a sudden, once they're separate from God, they're ashamed of themselves. And they go and hide, and they cover themselves. They cover their humanity. They cover their separateness from God. All right, look at Mark chapter 11, verses 13 and 14. Seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of the figs was not yet. Jesus answered and said unto it, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. Now if you can drop down to verse 20 and through 22. It's the next day. They're on their way back from Jerusalem, or back to Jerusalem. And in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. Peter, calling to remember it, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursest, it withered away. And Jesus answered and said unto them, have faith in God. Doesn't that sound like it doesn't fit? It did to me. That's why I keep going back over it. Jesus answered and said, have faith in God. The fig tree withered up. That's going to force me to have faith in God. The fig tree represented man trying to deal with his own weaknesses, his own separation from God, his distance from God, through his own effort, through his natural abilities. It also represented Israel under the law.
Yes.
Jesus says, watch the fig tree. When it blooms, you'll know it's not long before I'm coming back, right? Well, Israel is coming back as a nation. It's growing. It's bearing fruit. And so we know that the time is near for the Lord to return. But it also represents human effort to reconnect with God on their own or to cover the shame of their separation from God. So look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 15. And I'm saying a lot of us are running around with fig leaves instead of embracing the fact that we're one with God. Jesus cursed the fig tree for one reason, so that we wouldn't have an excuse to not trust him, to not be one with him. That's the metaphor there. So enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Many there be which go therein. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Now look, when I was a kid growing up, I was always taught, you know, we hear it all the time, you need to get on the straight and narrow. Right? You need to get on that where you don't screw up, where you're not deviating from the rules, right? And so we read that and we say, enter in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. We talked about being destroyed for a lack of knowledge, right? And many there be which go therein, go thereat. And so we think of that as being, okay, we need to get our act together.
or we're going to be destroyed. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to and life, and few that find it because of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are, they are ravening wolves. Okay? So Jesus is talking to Jews, because this is Jesus that's speaking this, right? He wasn't ministering to Gentiles. He was ministering to Jews that were under the law. And he's trying to get them prepared for what's coming after his death, burial, and resurrection, which is the kingdom of God and no longer the law.
Right.
He's trying to get them to gravitate towards his message of the kingdom. He's preaching the message of the kingdom over and over and over. He's not preaching the gospel, the law, although he's abiding by it. That isn't his message. His message is, there's something coming close. It's near. The kingdom of God is near you. It won't be long. And you're going to have to leave that false covering, that separation from God, and enter into this oneness with God.
Yes. Yes.
Not through your own effort, but through my sacrifice.
Uh-huh.
He's preparing them for the kingdom of God. Narrow. The narrow way is Jesus. Not us doing everything right. Look, I'll show you. Look at verse 9. Or excuse me, verse 19. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit, he hews it down and casts it into the fire. Same thing he did with the fig tree, right? The only way we bear fruit is by being connected to the vine. Destruction comes when it's about us disconnected from him. Destroyed for lack of knowledge. Undone because of a lack of knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Unable to do what we were created to do because of a lack of knowledge. Okay? John chapter 10. And I want to read verses 1 through 11, Mike. Verily, I say unto you, he that entereth in not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, same as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the potter openeth, the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And the stranger they will not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things they were which he spake unto them. Then said Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep, the narrow way.
Yep.
There's other ways to get into the sheepfold,
right. But
it don't make you a sheep. You can climb over, you can come around, you can do other things. The only way into the kingdom is through him. It's the narrow way. It's the doorway, through the door. I am the door, right? All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. Who came before him? He's telling this to Jews.
Right.
You're not saved by what you're doing. You're not saved. You're saved because you get connected to me. That's what's coming. That's they weren't saved. Their sins was pushed back until salvation could come. They were robbers, but the sheep didn't hear him. I'm the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. We say that's the devil. Well, the devil inspired it, but it isn't the devil that's killing and destroying. It's our lack of knowledge.
Come on.
It's our thinking it's something we're doing instead of something he's done. Right? Because he said they might... I've come that they might have life. and they'd have it more abundantly. I'm the good shepherd.
Yeah.
The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. That's the context in which he's telling this story.
Right.
So straight is the gate, narrow is the way, is the door, is Jesus himself.
Yes.
Period. Our connection with him puts us in the kingdom. Reveals our true identity. Mm-hmm. Narrow way is through Jesus, not the law. Not through human effort. Not through our separation from God and then just trying to do a bunch of stuff.
Amen.
It's by being one with him. You see, what I'm saying is, we're never going to do what this book tells us to do until this is our reality.
Mm-hmm.
Look, if it would work some other way, we'd have seen more happening than we have for the last 2,000 years.
Right.
I believe that this awareness, this knowledge, this awakening is what ushers in the final great harvest.
Amen.
When the body of Christ literally believes in their oneness with God.
Amen.
When they start walking no more in their natural way of seeing themselves, but in Christ. So that Christ lives his life through them. And again, this is not about our perfection.
Mm-hmm.
This is about our awareness. Go back to verse 8, Mike. All that ever came before me are thieves, robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. Anything outside of Christ is a lie. It's a thief. It's a robber. It's somebody trying to get things outside of their connection with God. It's the glass of vodka every morning so you can do what it is you think you're supposed to be doing. It's our human excuses for not doing what God says you're capable of doing as long as you're one with me. Am I making sense?
Yep.
Every way outside of Christ, he says, is a thief and a liar. Now, we could go on with this. I'm not going to, just for the sake of time. But he even goes on to say, call me Lord, Lord. I never knew you. Oh, but Lord, we cast out demons. We did this, we did that. No, you. I didn't know you because we were never one. You did this through your religious belief or through your sense of, you know, spiritual power. But you weren't one with me.
Mm-hmm.
You weren't focused on this oneness with me, which is what I come to give you, to reconnect you, to put you back, to get rid of the fig leaves, to get rid of your phony, so you can be the perfect that I created. Because that's the only one that's going to be able to do what you were created to do.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why the whole world is running around nuts, doing drugs, alcohol, all the other stuff that we do, trying to find our purpose or trying to find some satisfaction, and it'll never be found outside of Christ.
That's right.
See, the world and religion offers us figs, fruit, but all it's got is leaves. I don't want this church, and for sure I don't want to be a fig tree with just leaves.
Right.
I'd rather be small figs, deformed figs, imperfect fig, but figs.
Amen.
Because God can make figs edible.
Amen.
Pleasing. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
See, it
robbers, it robs us. It puts us away from God. It separates us from God. Verse 10. The thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Destroy. I'm come they might have life, and they might have it more abundantly. Life. The life that we live is no longer us, but Christ in us. Our life is a lack of knowledge, a lack of oneness with God, and it is destructive. The thief tries to get us to operate any way except one with Christ. Mm-hmm. And any way except one with Christ robs, kills, and destroys. One with Christ, and you have life, not just life, but God life. Abundant life.
Amen.
John 14, verse 6. So, I'm not trying to be, you know, depressing here, but this is serious. We should be happy, but we ought to be serious about it. Amen?
Amen.
So Jesus saith unto him, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. You see, we think one thing, but God knows another.
Right.
That's why we got to be one with Him.
Yep.
We'll fool ourselves into screwing everything up. Now, you might be afraid of change, but God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That being said, I've learned over the last 40 years, God always challenges the conventional,
there you go.
The traditional, the rational, and the logical.
Mm-hmm.
Every time God has asked me to do something, it didn't make sense to me.
Right.
But if I did it, I was blessed.
There you go.
And it made perfect sense in hindsight. So with all of the information that the world throws at us and all of our frustration with it, remember, we're really after knowledge. We're after revelation.
Right.
We're after life. So 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. Whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Verse 20. And we know that the Son of God has come, hath given us an understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. This is knowledge. This is the knowledge that keeps us from destruction. Galatians chapter 2, verses 16 through 21. Mike, I'm about done here. Galatians 2, 16 through 21. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. But if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, is therefore Christ the minister of sin? God forbid. For if I build again the things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for
For if righteousness came by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. See, the divine pivot point here is verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet it's not me that's living, it's Christ living in me. In other words, he's saying, I can't, but God can. See, you only think you know what God's up to. You know, we presume too much sometimes when we ought to just be focusing on this oneness with Him, and He will direct our steps. He will bring it to pass.
Amen.
All right, last scripture, John chapter 6, verses 53 through 58.
Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. So let me just wrap it up with this. Free buffet, endless refills. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's what he's telling. That's the knowledge. We're settling for information when it's knowledge that God is trying to give. Great blessing, because it's in this reality that everything in here is fulfilled. It's by this that miracles take place.
Amen.
Not by us, not by our effort, not even by our feelings of compassion, but it's by our connection, our oneness with Him, that all of this is fulfilled. If we get our eyes off of us, we can set Israel free from Egypt.
There you go.
Amen. We can bring them out. We can part the Red Sea. We can get water from the rock. We can take them into the promised land where there are houses they didn't build. Amen.
Amen.
Fields they didn't plant. See in the spirit, or otherwise we're like the 10 spies that came back. Oh, there's giants over there. And we end up another 2,000 years wandering in the wilderness waiting for another generation for God to choose. And I'm saying God has chosen this generation.
Come on.
But we've got to see ourselves one with Him, connected with Him. Amen?
Amen.
And then nothing shall be impossible. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. So it's not a sad thing. It's a just, come on, get smart. Let's recognize what God's doing in each and every one of us. It's not something we have to do. We already got it, man. All we got to do is walk in it. And nothing will be impossible.
Amen.
It's like Suzanne, just like you're talking about with her girlfriend. Look, you could have went the other way. You'd have got, instead of getting there 4 minutes late, you might not have got there at all.
Right?
Right.
Right.
You didn't have to make a plan. You're just one with God. You're just doing what comes natural to you, talking, sharing Jesus, you know, and your confidence in Him, and what happens? You're protected. You get to your place on time without all of the other hassle.
Yep.
I'm saying, forget about the fig leaves.
Yep.
We've got a robe of righteousness. We've got Jesus Himself as a covering. We just need to be us, the unique you that God created you to be, and watch
what he does through that.
Amen.
It's amazing. Praise the Lord. More importantly, it's supernatural. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate your patience tonight. Thank you all for being here. Meditate on this. Mull it over. Pray about it. Talk in tongues. And watch what God's going to do. Amen. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. God bless all of you.